Welcome. I'm so glad we're able to worship together today. We are starting a new sermon series called Fresh Start. Jesus offers us new beginnings, but those fresh starts are more complicated, more nuanced than we might expect. Today, we're talking about what it means to pick up our cross and follow Jesus. As we prepare to worship God and hear His word, let's calm our hearts and our minds. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you are a Lord who walks beside your people. So we pray for people who walk for justice. You are a Lord who raises up those who are bent low. So we pray for those held down by the grindings of life and the indifference of the world. You are a Lord who feeds the hungry. So we pray for all who long for bread and the means to provide it. You are a Lord who celebrates the small and insignificant. So we pray for the children and those who are never noticed. You are the Lord who says, "Follow me." So we pray for courage and faith in our hearts that we may take up the cross and find it leads to life. Amen.
Today's scripture reading comes from Mark chapter 8, verses 27 through 38. Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi, and on the way he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist, and others Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Messiah." And he sternly ordered them not to tell anyone about him. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed after 3 days, rise again. He said all of this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any wish to come after me, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it. And those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what they can give in return to their life. Those who are ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father and with the holy angels." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Today, we embark on a 4-week series which addresses the fresh starts Jesus offers all who follow him. Who doesn't want a fresh start, a clean slate? That is exactly what Jesus offers us. He gives us a chance to begin anew every single day. But the fresh start Jesus offers is not just a simple clean slate. When we say yes to God's new beginning in our lives, we are saying yes to an adventure that will require courage, perseverance, and boldness. We are saying yes to having our world turned upside down and inside out. We are saying yes to being stirred up and to stir others up. Today's scripture reading is asking us, are you ready for the journey? Jesus' disciples had been following and learning from him, but that was only a glimpse of the fresh start that would change their lives. In today's story, Jesus challenges his disciples by asking, "Who do people say that I am?" This is a relatively easy question because the disciples simply report on the things they have heard among the crowds. Some say John the Baptist, others Elijah, and still others one of the prophets. Now, Jesus' ministry of preaching, teaching, and healing did indeed resemble the great prophets of Israel. So those responses were not far off the mark, but they did not quite get to the heart of the matter. So then Jesus asks a more specific question. And you, who do you say that I am? Peter, the guy with a big heart and a big mouth, says first, you are the Messiah. Now, we know the whole story, and we know that Peter has given the right answer. But Peter's expectations of the Messiah, along with all of the Jewish people of the time, was very different from Jesus and his ministry so far. You see, the title Messiah in Hebrew meant an anointed king, expected to come and free Israel from their Gentile oppressors, sort of a warrior king. But Jesus was different. He was far different what Peter expected. And he asked his disciples not to tell anybody that he is indeed the long-awaited Messiah. Why? Why did Jesus not want people to know? Well, right at that point, Jesus wasn't ready. If people knew that he was the Messiah, they would stop listening to everything he was teaching and follow him, their king, their warrior, missing all of the point of Jesus coming. What they had expected was not true. And Jesus wanted to show that the Messiah was humble and came to suffer. This was a new challenge, a new start for those who truly knew Jesus and his purpose on earth. From there, Jesus gets to the hard stuff. Not only is the Messiah not a warrior king, but he is instead humble, and he will suffer at the hands of those who are waiting, the chief elders and the priests. Jesus tells them he will die. Talk about a paradigm shift. When I was young and it was time for me to get my pointe shoes in ballet class, I was so excited, as many girls are. I assumed that I would put my shoes on and, like the sugar plum fairy had handed them to me, I would stand on my toes and twirl around beautifully, and glitter would fall upon me, and it was going to be beautiful. But I was very disappointed. I put on those pointe shoes. I went to the bar. First of all, it was very hard to get up on my toes. And when I did, it hurt. It was so painful, and I was so disappointed. It was not at all what I expected it to be. Expecting one amazing thing and then receiving something that is difficult and painful is a huge shift in our reality. And it takes time to accept it. But Peter took no time. He rebuked or scolded Jesus, telling him that he was wrong. And after all, the Messiah could never be so weak as to be punished and executed. But Jesus stopped Peter in his tracks. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. Who would ever want Jesus to say something like that to them? Peter must have been startled, to say the least. So why did Jesus say that? He goes on to say that Peter was focusing on what he wanted from a Messiah, what he hoped Jesus would be, what he thought his people needed. Peter wanted a superhero. Christians today still define Jesus as a sort of superhero. He is the mighty man who flies in with his cape, fixes all our troubles with magical powers, and gives us a happy ending and the conclusion of a tale that ends with a simple the end. But Jesus is more than that. And our wish for Jesus to be a simple superhero takes away from the multifaceted God in human form, our Savior, our Redeemer, and our friend. Scholar Elizabeth Johnson gives us insight to the next part of the story. Jesus actually expects his disciples to follow him on the path of his suffering and death. If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their lives will lose it, and those who lose their lives for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. Johnson continues saying, I think it is important to be clear about what Jesus means by taking up the cross. He's not talking about the suffering that is a simple part of life in a broken world. Everything from annoying neighbors to serious illness to natural disasters. Neither is Jesus telling us to seek out suffering or martyrdom. Jesus himself did not seek it, but he did foresee that it would be inevitable outcome of his mission. Jesus speaks of losing our lives for his sake and for the sake of the gospel. Taking up our cross means being willing to suffer the consequences of following Jesus faithfully, whatever those consequences might be. It means putting Jesus' priorities and purposes ahead of our own comfort and security. It means being willing to lose our lives by spending them for others, using our time, our resources, our gifts, and our energy so that others might experience God's love made known in Jesus Christ. I like her summary. Especially her last point, Jesus is not asking us to stand in front of a speeding train and yelling John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son. No, losing our lives means making a change, shifting our narratives, making our lives not about ourselves, but about others. We are to let go of our selfish wants and desires, and instead follow Jesus' teaching by putting others first. Loving our neighbors just as much as we love ourselves. Give others food and clothes that we have stashed away in case we might possibly need them another day. Lay aside 2 hours of resting on our weekend in exchange for helping a friend. Volunteering in ministry and aiding others, challenging people to make change in society where people are overlooked, marginalized, or mistreated. Loving everybody despite our difference, loving everybody, period. There is a myriad of ways we can step away from our lives that are focused on ourselves and ourselves alone. Christ's offer to give us a fresh start gives us a new way to live, but it's not the way we expect. A new life in Christ heals, forgives, and revives us, but it also spurs us ahead to following Christ's example. A fresh start requires courage, focus, and practice. It's time we accept the new life and the fresh start Jesus offers. We can do it, for all things are possible in Christ Jesus. And all of God's freshly changed children said, Amen.
you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes an orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King above.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.